بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. حديث نمبر 19 on the authority of Abu Tha'laba al-Khushani رضي الله عنه. He says that I said to the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام إنا بأرض قوم أهل الكتاب أفنأكل في آنيتهم. We are living in the land of the people of the book. Shall we eat from their containers? So the Prophet replied, لا تأكلوا فيها إلا أن لا تجدوا غيرها فاغسلوها وكلوا فيها. متفق عليه. He said, do not eat from them, meaning from their containers, except if you do not find other than their containers. So in that case, you can take the containers, wash them, and then eat in it. The hadith is متفق عليه. We take from this hadith that the food containers and utensils of the kuffar are tahir, because the Prophet allowed the Muslim to eat from them. And if they had been najis, then he would not have allowed to eat from them. But he allowed Abu Tha'laba to eat from them, and he gave him two conditions. First condition, that you do not find other than their utensils. And the second condition is that if you don't find other than their utensils, then you can take them, but you must wash them first and then eat from it. We take from this hadith that it is permissible to live amongst the kuffar, because the Prophet ﷺ did not order Abu Tha'laba to make hijrah to the land of the Muslims. However, we say that this is the case, but not in the absolute sense. It is true you can live amongst the kuffar on the important condition that you are able to outwardly practice your deen. If you are not able to practice your deen properly, then it is obligatory upon you, if you are able to make hijrah. Because if you are not able to practice your deen, or perhaps you fall into committing sins because there is too much fitna in the place of the kuffar, and if you were to die in this state, you would be from the ظَالِمِي أَنفُسِهِمْ, those who were oppressing their own selves. You are oppressing yourself because you were not practicing your deen, or you were committing sins, and you did not leave the place which was pushing you to commit sins. And as we find in the Qur'an, the Malaika would tell those people who were not able to practice their deen freely, أَوَلَمْ تَكُنْ أَرْضُ اللَّهِ وَاسِعَةً فَتُهَاجِرُوا فِيهَا. Was the earth of Allah not wide enough that you could make hijrah therein? So if you are able to make hijrah, then there is no excuse. It is obligatory upon you to make hijrah. If you are not able to properly practice your deen, which is to say, perform all the obligatory duties, and to refrain from that which is haram. Because some places might attract you into committing sins. For example, if you're living in a place in which there are many casinos and nightclubs, so this would be attracting you to gamble. So if you fall into this type of sin, and this place is attracting you to this sin, then it is obligatory upon you to leave the place. We take from this hadith also the eagerness of the Sahaba to gain knowledge, because Abu Tha'laba here comes to the Prophet asking him about the Islamic rulings. And they would seek knowledge in order to implement it in their lives. And these are from the fruits of knowledge. We learn from the hadith that the Prophet gave two conditions for eating from the containers of the kuffar. In actual fact, these conditions are not obligatory, such that if you were able to find other than the utensils of the kuffar, and you still ate from them, this would be halal for you. And if you were to eat from the utensils of the kuffar without having washed them, then this would also be permissible. Because the original ruling is that everything is tahir until you have evidence that it is najis. So if a kafir gives you a container, and you cannot see any signs of najasa on this container, then the ruling is that it is tahir. So if you were to eat from it without having washed it, it would be halal for you. And we know that the Yahud invited the Prophet ﷺ over for some barley and bread, and the Prophet ate from their containers, and he did not wash them beforehand. That's because the original ruling is that these containers are all pure, even if they are coming from the kuffar. But the Prophet told Abu Tha'laba to wash the containers to be on the safe side. Nowadays, if a kafir was to give you a container, be it for food or drink, then it is very improbable that he will give you this container without having first washed it himself. Because people just don't give each other dirty containers. The question is, why did the Prophet say, do not eat from them if you can find other than their containers? Because we have just said that their containers are halal for us. So what is the point in making this condition? The reason why the Prophet made this condition is to keep away from the kuffar. Because the more you borrow from the kuffar and they borrow from you, then the closer you will get to them. So the Prophet ﷺ is encouraging the Muslim to keep away from the kuffar. Because the more you intermingle with them, the more love will foster into your heart for the kuffar. And the more love fosters in your heart for the kuffar, the more this will damage your iman. And the more you would want to imitate the kuffar. because naturally you would want to imitate those whom you love. But this does not mean to say you do not give kuffar their rights. For example, you could have kuffar who are your neighbors, or kuffar who are your close relatives. So it is obligatory upon the Muslims to treat these kuffar nicely and to give them their rights. Their rights as a neighbor or their rights as a family member. Also, we find it is permissible for Muslims and kuffar to exchange gifts and containers, because this comes under dealing with the kuffar, which you are of course allowed to do. And it is also part of giving the neighbor his rights and your family members their rights also, even if they are kuffar. What is haram is to have your hearts hankering after them, or inclining towards them, or perhaps believing in their false beliefs. So the hadith is telling us that it is permissible, if you are not able to find an alternative, to borrow food utensils from the kuffar. Can we say that it is permissible to borrow other than food utensils from the kuffar? This needs to be avoided, because if you were to borrow things from the kuffar, then they will see themselves superior to you, and they will see themselves as doing you a favor. So whenever somebody does somebody else a favor, they are morally superior to them, and this needs to be avoided. In a version of this hadith, narrated in the collection of Al-Bayhaqi, it says that Abu Tha'laba says that we are living with the people of the book, and they cook khinzir, which is pig, in their pots, and they drink khamr in their utensils. And the Prophet ﷺ ordered him to eat and drink from utensils other than their utensils, but if he cannot find them, then he must wash them first and then eat and drink from them. So many ulama have taken from this narration that khamr is najis, because the Prophet ordered Abu Tha'laba to wash the containers in which khamr is being used by the people of the book. And so this order to wash the utensils means that khamr must be najis. And this is the opinion of the majority of the ulama, is that khamr is najis. However, this hadith is mutashabih, meaning to say you can have different interpretations. It is not very clear in stating that khamr is najis, because when the Prophet is giving the order to clean the utensils, he could be giving the order to clean the utensils because of the khinzir, because of the pig, which is mentioned in the narration. And we know that the khinzir is najis. Rather, the correct opinion is that khamr is not najis, because when it was made haram, the people of Medina who had khamr in their containers, they spilt khamr in the streets of Al-Madinah. And the Prophet ﷺ did not say that this is not permissible, because we know that if khamr was najis, or any other najasa for that matter, it is not permissible to throw it in the streets, because najasa must be removed. It must not be thrown in the streets where other people will be affected by it. In the same way, for example, you would not throw urine in the streets where people are walking and sitting, because they will be affected by this urine, and we know urine is najis. Likewise with feces, you would not put it in the street, because najasa needs to be removed. It must not be put on the street. And when the people poured the khamr down in the streets to get rid of the khamr because it had been made haram, then the Prophet ﷺ did not rebuke them for doing this, and neither did he correct them. And if somebody was to say, well, perhaps the Prophet ﷺ did not know about this, then we say, yes, the Prophet may not have known about this, but Allah Jalla wa Ala certainly did, and Allah does not keep quiet about something which is wrong. Hadith number 20. On the authority of Imran ibn Husayn radiallahu anh, he says that the Prophet ﷺ and his companions made wudu from a mazada, or a water skin, of a mushrika woman. The hadith is muttafaqun alayh. The key word here is the mazada, which is a water skin, and it is made out of two skins of animals and a third skin in between these two skins, so as to make this container wide and expansive, so it takes more water. So the point is that this water skin is taken from the sacrificed animals of the mushrikeen. And we know that the sacrificed animals of the mushrikeen are in fact dead meat, because any animal which is not slaughtered in the name of Allah is in fact dead. And we know that dead animals are haram. This is of course dead animals which have a flowing blood. So if these dead animals are najis and haram, then the skin is also najis. So this would basically mean that it is not permissible to make wudu from this container made out of the skins of a dead animal, because the skin is najis. But here we find that the Prophet and the companions did make wudu out of this mazada. So why is this? This hadith is there to explain that the skin of a dead animal becomes pure after it has been tanned. Some of the scholars of the Hanabila say that the skin of a dead animal after it has been tanned can only be used when the skin is dry. But when the skin is wet, it is najis, and so it will transfer the najasa, because wet substances transfer najasa. And this narration refutes that idea, because of course a water skin is wet, that's the whole point, it has water in it. But despite this, the Prophet ﷺ made wudu from it. In this story, there is also a sign of prophethood in that the Prophet and the companions made wudu from this mazada, and the water did not decrease, which of course goes against the natural laws of science. The more water you use, of course, the less there will remain in the container. But in this case, in the story, it did not decrease. And this is one of the miracles of the Prophet. And also in the story, we learn that as a reward, the Prophet ﷺ gave this mushrik woman some dates for her and her orphan kids as a reward for allowing the Prophet and the companions to use the water container. So we take that when somebody does you a favor, you should return the favor. If you do not return the favor, then the one who did you a favor will feel morally superior to you, that he has done you a favor and you have not given anything in return. So he is on a higher level than you, morally speaking. It's like you need him and he does not need you. And so you as a Muslim may develop an inferiority complex. So Muslims are required not to allow this to happen to them. If somebody does you a favor, you must return it. You must not allow anyone from the Muslims or the kafir to feel morally superior to you. And it is from the sunnah that the Prophet would accept gifts and give gifts back as a reward as well. We also learn from the full version of this narration that it is permissible to speak to an ajnabiyya, which is a woman not related to you, so she is halal to marry. So it is permissible to speak to such a woman for a genuine reason, because this woman was a widow and she had orphan children, and the companions saw her on a camel and she had the water skins with her. So they asked her to go to the Prophet ﷺ. So the point is, they were speaking to her and she was an ajnabiyya. So if it is for a genuine need and you are safe from fitna, then it is permissible to speak to an ajnabiyya. Also in the long story, we find that this woman was on a journey. But this cannot be taken as an evidence that a woman is allowed to travel without a mahram, because this woman was at that time a mushrika. Hadith number 21. On the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he says that the drinking cup of the Prophet ﷺ became cracked. And so to fix it, the Prophet used a silver thread. Al-Bukhari reported this hadith. We have previously stated, using the narrations, that it is haram for a Muslim, man or woman, to use food utensils made out of gold or silver. But in this hadith, we find something of an exception, in that if there is a need for you to use some silver on the cup so as to fix it, then there is no problem with this. And when we say need, it is those reasons other than adornment. So for you to have any amount of gold or silver on the cups or utensils just as an adornment, then this is not permissible. But for a need, a certain amount of silver can be used. We take from the fawaid of this hadith that the Prophet ﷺ was eager to preserve wealth, because the Prophet could easily have just thrown this cup away and bought a new one, but rather he wants to preserve the wealth. And so wealth has a sanctity to it. And Allah Jalla wa Ala says about wealth in Surah An-Nisa, وَلَا تُؤْتُوا السُّفَهَاءَ أَمْوَالَكُمُ الَّتِي جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ قِيَامًا وَارْزُقُوهُمْ فِيهَا وَاكْسُوهُمْ وَقُولُوا لَهُمْ قَوْلًا مَعْرُوفًا. And do not give the foolish people their wealth, which Allah has made as a means of living for you, but rather give them their provisions from their wealth, and clothe them, and speak to them a noble word. So the point about wealth is that Allah Jalla wa Ala has made this wealth to keep you upright in this life. So therefore it has a sanctity about it, and it must not be wasted. Also we take from the fawaid of this hadith that the Prophet ﷺ was humble, in that he did not mind using a cracked cup to drink from. So he was not too proud, such that he only wants to use the best equipment. Some ulama say that you can use some silver to fix the cup, but you must not put your mouth on this silver when drinking from the cup. And this is the wrong opinion, because this hadith says that he used the silver to fix the cup, but it does not say that he avoided touching his mouth to the silver. So the narration is general and we must keep it on a general level. Can we use this narration and make an analogy to gold? such that if your cup or your plate is broken, then you're allowed to use a piece of gold to fix it? The answer is, no, we cannot, because gold is of a higher status than silver. And silver and gold, therefore, are not inherently the same. And the asl about gold is that it is haram. So if you're going to take it away from the asl, then you need evidence from the text, and there is none. And a qiyas is not good enough to take the ruling away from the asl. As for gold and silver jewelry, then this is permissible for women in accordance with their customs. It is permissible for men to wear rings made of silver. And in fact, they can use silver in their clothing also, because there is nothing to say that this is haram. Rather, what is haram for them is gold and silk. And this also shows us the difference between gold and silver. Gold is not allowed for men to be worn, but silver is. Next, the Shaykh said, بَابُ إِزَالَةِ النَّجَاسَ وَبَيَانِهَا. The chapter of removing a najasa and making plain what najasa is. First of all, let us explain what a najasa is. In the language, a najasa is something which is deemed to be dirty. In the technical terminology of the Sharia, some ulama have said that it is a specific type of dirt which prevents you from your prayer being correct. So for example, if you have urine on your clothes or your body, then you cannot pray in this state until you remove this najasa, which is urine in this case. Other ulama have said that a najasa is that which is not permissible to be consumed due to a reason other than it harming the body or the mind, or it being haram from the text of the Sharia, or it being seen as something which is dirty. So they say it is anything which is haram to consume, not for these three reasons. And najasa can be of two types. Number one is a najasa al-hukmiya. This is a substance which has been given the ruling of it being najis because there is some impurity that comes upon it. For example, your clothing is pure, but if some impurity comes upon these clothes of yours, then your clothes become najis. Not because they are najis in and of themselves, but because of some impurity or some najasa which has come on them. So they can be returned to their state of being tahir, but you would have to remove the najasa first. For example, if some feces come onto your clothing, then your clothing are najis. But they can be restored to their tahir state by removing the impurity. Then the second type is a najasatul ayniya. This is something which is najis in and of itself, and it is not possible for it to be pure. For example, the dung of animals which is not halal to be eaten, this is a najasa and it is impure in and of itself. So no matter how many times you wash it with water, it will always remain impure or najis. Most of the ulama say that najasa can only be removed with water. Imam Abu Hanifa and Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahumallah, they say that a najasa can be removed by anything. As long as the najasa itself is removed, then we say that the item becomes pure. And this is the correct opinion. We say that a najasa is an impure or dirty entity. When it is removed, then its ruling is also removed. Items which are najis, they have a specific taste, smell and color. What is important is for the taste and smell to be removed. If some color of the najasa remains, then this does not harm. And we say that the najasa has been removed. So upon this, if you have some najasa on your clothes and you wash it, but some color of the najasa remains, then we say that your clothes are tahir, as long as there is no smell or taste of the najasa which remains on the clothes. So for example, if you take your clothes to the dry cleaners and your clothing has some najasa on it, we know that the dry cleaners do not use water to clean your clothes. This is why it's called dry cleaning. So does this mean that if you have najasa on your clothing, you cannot take the clothes to the dry cleaners because they do not use water? And remember, the majority opinion is that only water can remove a najasa. So according to the majority opinion, it is not permissible for you to take your clothes to the dry cleaners because they do not use water to remove the najasa. But according to the correct opinion of Abu Hanifa and Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah and a few others, it is permissible to take your clothing to the dry cleaners because whenever the najasa is removed, this is the bottom line. And the method of removing the najasa is not important. Remember the three characteristics: taste, smell and color. The taste and smell must be removed. As for if there are any remnants of the color of the najasa, then this does not harm, as stated before. Another question is, Is the intention important when removing the najasa? Meaning to say, when you're removing the najasa, must you have your intention to remove the najasa or not? Because all your actions are judged in accordance with your intention. We say, removing the najasa is not an act of worship, therefore does not require an intention. Thus, based upon this, if you have some najasa on your clothing, and it rains, and the rain removes the najasa, and of course you did not intend for this najasa to be removed, because you did not know it was going to rain. So is your najasa removed? We say, yes it is, and that the intention does not matter, and is not a condition for the removal of the najasa. And it's not like an act of worship in which the intention is important. So for example, if you were to wake up for Salatul Fajr, and you go all the way up to Salatul Maghrib, and you realize that you haven't eaten anything, can you now, after Salatul Maghrib, say, I intended to fast that day? The answer is no, because you needed to have your intention beforehand, either before Salatul Fajr, if it was a wajib fast, or during the day if it was a nafila. Hadith number 22, on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu. He says that the Prophet والسلام, was asked about al-khamar, can it be taken to make vinegar? He replied, la, no. Imam Muslim reported it, and at-Tirmidhi said, it is a hadith which is hasan sahih. Of course, the hadith is authentic. This hadith proves that it is not permissible to change khamar into khal, which is vinegar. First of all, khamar comes from takhmir, which means to cover, and it is everything which covers the intellect or clouds the intellect by way of pleasure. So upon this, we would not say that anesthetics which the doctors give to patients when performing operations, that they are khamar. Because even though it does cloud the intellect, it is not by way of pleasure. So we know that al-khamr is haram, and this is known by necessity in al-Islam, such that a person living in a Muslim community and he denies that khamr is haram, then the ulama say that he is a kafir. Because anyone who denies something that is known by necessity in Islam, he is a kafir. In the same way, for example, if somebody says that committing zina is halal, then it is known by necessity that zina is haram. So anyone who denies this is a kafir. Or for example, if somebody denies the obligation of the prayer, then this is also kufr. Because these types of things are known by necessity. Meaning to say, it is not possible for you not to know them. Of course, these things apply when you're living in a Muslim community. Otherwise, if a new Muslim comes along and he denies these things, then we have to let him off because he has not been living in a Muslim community. In the early days of Islam, khamr was halal, as Allah Jalla wa Ala mentions in Surah An-Nahl, وَمِن ثَمَرَاتِ النَّخِيلِ وَالْأَعْنَابِ تَتَّخِذُونَ مِنْهُ سَكَرًا وَرِزْقًا حَسَنًا إِنَّ فِي ذَلِكَ لَآيَةً لِقَوْمِ يَعْقِلُونَ. And from the fruits of the date palm tree and the grapes, you derive an intoxicant and a goodly provision. Verily in this is a sign for those who use their intellect. So we find in this ayah that Allah Jalla wa Ala is actually acknowledging people consuming intoxicants. But of course gradually it was made haram, and the Prophet والسلام, said in the authentic hadith in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, Al-Khamru Ummul Khaba'ith. وَمَنْ شَرِبَهَا لَمْ تُقْبَلْ مِنْهُ صَلَاةُ أَرْبَعِينَ يَوْمًا وَمَنْ مَاتَ وَهِيَ فِي بَطْنِهِ مَاتَ مِيتَةً جَاهِلِيَّةً. That al-khamr is the mother of all evil. And whoever drinks it, 40 days of prayer will not be accepted from him. And if he dies and it is in his belly, then he will die a jahiliyyah death. This hadith particularly is not talking about khamr being haram, but rather it is talking about changing khamr into vinegar. And from this hadith we learn that it is not permissible, if you have khamr, to change it into vinegar. Because the Prophet والسلام, said, la, no, when he was asked about changing khamr into vinegar. Likewise in the Sunan, we have that Abu Talha radiallahu anhu came to the Prophet والسلام, mentioning that he had some khamr which belonged to some yatim who were with him. Can he change this khamr into vinegar? So that at least the yatim, which are the orphans, could make use of it. And the Prophet والسلام, ordered him to spill the khamr out. First of all, let us know that vinegar is halal to be consumed, and it is tahir, because the Prophet والسلام, himself consumed it, and he said, نِعْمَ الْإِدَامُ الْخَلْ. What an excellent condiment is vinegar. So vinegar is a side dish, and it is permissible to consume. and this ruling is not abrogated, as we shall soon see. However, this idea of changing al-khamr into al-khal is of three categories. Number one, if a Muslim changes khamr into vinegar, then you are not allowed to buy this. And this action of changing the khamr into vinegar is haram, because what the Muslim is ordered to do is to spill the khamr out, just as we found in the narration of Abu Talha, that the Prophet ﷺ ordered Abu Talha to spill out the khamr. So this is how the Muslim treats khamr. He has to spill it out, not give it to somebody else as a gift, not to preserve it, and not to change it into vinegar, but rather to get rid of it. So if a Muslim changes the khamr into vinegar, then it is not allowed to buy or sell this, because you will be helping him in performing this evil action. The second category is that if a Jew or a Christian or somebody in whose religion alcohol is permitted, he changes it into vinegar, this is allowed to be consumed and bought and sold, because this person in whose religion alcohol is permitted, he himself has done nothing wrong. And all he has done is to change this alcohol into vinegar. And when you are buying the vinegar, then you are buying something which is tahir, pure and halal to be consumed. So it does not hold true that you are consuming something which is haram, as vinegar is clearly halal, because the Prophet ﷺ consumed it, and this ruling is not abrogated. We only abrogate a ruling when it is impossible to combine between the evidences. But here it is possible to combine between the evidences. And we say that the one in whose religion alcohol is permitted, if he turns it into vinegar, then this is permissible to be consumed. But not if a Muslim does it, because what is obligatory upon him is to spill the alcohol or any intoxicant out. And hence it is not permissible for any other Muslim to help him in this evil action of his, where he turned the alcohol into vinegar. The third category is when the khamr turns into vinegar naturally, and this is permissible to be consumed. The other opinion is that an-najasa does not change through istihala, which is the natural changing of a substance. So they would say that khamr will not change to becoming tahir through istihala, when it changes its form naturally into khal, which is vinegar. And they use as evidence that the Prophet ﷺ forbade the eating of the jallala, which is the animal in which most of its food is najis. So for example, it may eat feces and it may drink urine. So most of its food intake is from najasa. The Prophet forbade that this animal be eaten. So they say that this najasa does not transform into something which is pure. Hence, the animal is forbidden to be eaten. However, we say that yes, it's not permissible to eat this jallala. However, it is to be given some time so that the impurity can be removed from the jallala. And then it is permissible to be eaten. So if a chicken eats feces, then you have to wait for a few days for this najasa to be removed from the chicken, and then it is permissible to be slaughtered. And the correct opinion is that a najasa is changed into something which is tahir through al-istihala. Remember, najasa has three qualities: the taste, smell and color. If these qualities change, then we say that the najasa has been removed. The Shaykh has put this hadith in this chapter to prove to us that khamr is najis. Because remember, we are in the book of Tahara, and we are dealing with what is najis and what is tahir. And the opinion that al-khamr is najis is the opinion held by the majority of the ulama, but there does not seem to be a very clear evidence for this. One of the evidences which they used is that which we narrated beforehand about Abu Tha'laba al-Khushani and the Prophet ﷺ ordering him to clean the utensils first and then eat and drink from them. And of course, Abu Tha'laba mentioned that these people of the book cook khinzir in their utensils and also drink khamr. And so the Prophet ordered him to wash these utensils, because these ulama say it's because khamr is najis. But firstly, this version of the hadith is not in the Sahihain. And secondly, it is mutashabih, because he could be referring to him washing the utensils because the khinzir is najis, not necessarily because the khamr is najis. Also, they use the evidence from the Qur'an when Allah Jalla wa'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِنَّمَا الْخَمْرُ وَالْمَيْسِرُ وَالْأَنصَابُ وَالْأَزْلَامُ رِجْسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ فَاجْتَنِبُوهُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ. O you who believe, khamr and maisir, which is gambling, and ansab, which is when you sacrifice to your false gods, and azlam, which is when you shoot arrows in order to seek a decision. He says these are all rijis from the works of shaitan. And the word rijis means najis, impurity. So they say this proves that alcohol or any other khamr is impure, because Allah Jalla wa'ala describes it as rijis. And we know rijis means najis, because Allah Jalla wa'ala says in Surah Al-An'am, قُلْ لَا أَجِدُ فِي مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيَّ مُحَرَّمًا عَلَىٰ طَاعِمٍ يَطَعْمُهُ إِلَّا أَنْ يَكُونَ مَيْتَةً أَوْ دَمًا مَسْفُوحًا أَوْ لَحْمَ خِنْزِيرٍ فَإِنَّهُ رِجِسْ أَوْ فِسْقًا أُهِلَّ لِغَيْرِ اللَّهِ بِهِ. Al-Ayah. Say, I do not find in that which has been revealed to me anything haram for the one who wants to eat it, except if it be dead meat, or poured out blood, or the meat of a pig, because all of that is rijis, which means najis, or that which has been sacrificed for the false gods, up till the end of the ayah. But we say this is, again, not a clear evidence that khamr is najis, because the ayah says, رِجِسٌ مِّنْ عَمَلِ الشَّيْطَانِ, an impurity from the works of shaitan. So it is not a physical impurity like urine, but rather it is a spiritual impurity. So all evil deeds are impure. This is like gambling. You cannot say that gambling is a physical impurity. It doesn't make sense. But rather you can say that gambling is a spiritual impurity because it's an evil deed. Similarly, when Allah Jalla wa'ala says, إِنَّمَا الْمُشْرِكُونَ najis, the mushrikun are najis, we cannot say that they are physically impure. Rather, their beliefs are impure, because all evil deeds and false beliefs are all impurities. Rather, we have evidence which suggests that khamr is pure when the people poured out khamr in the streets of Al-Madinah when it became haram. The Prophet ﷺ did not rebuke them, nor did Allah Jalla wa'ala send down any ayah telling them that this is wrong. And if something wrong is done, Allah Jalla wa'ala does not keep quiet about it. Either He will send down an ayah, or He will inform the Prophet ﷺ, who would say something. This is why Jabir radiallahu anh said that they would be practicing al-azl, which is coitus interruptus, during sexual intercourse. He said that they would be practicing this whilst the Qur'an was being sent down. So he's using the fact that Allah did not say anything to prove that this act is permissible. Which proves that if something wrong is done, then Allah does not keep quiet about it. Because if the Prophet did not know, Allah Jalla wa'ala does know. And Allah Jalla wa'ala also says about the munafiqeen, يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَا يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مَعْهُمْ إِذْ يُبَيِّتُونَ مِنَ الْقَوْلِ مَا لَا يَرْضَى وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ مُحِيطًا. They hide themselves from the people, but they cannot hide themselves from Allah. And He is with them when they are planning, which Allah is not pleased with, and Allah encompasses all that they do. Also, we know that the Prophet ﷺ did not order the people to wash their containers which had khamr in them after the people poured out the khamr. So if khamr had been najis, it would have been obligatory on the Prophet to order the people to wash the containers, because you must wash off the najasa. In the same way, for example, when the Prophet ﷺ ordered the people to throw out the meat of the donkey which they were cooking, because it is rijis, meaning najis, he ordered the people to break the pots in which the meat was in. And so it was suggested to him, can we clean them at least? And the Prophet said, or you clean them. So he ordered, either you break the pots because they are najis, or you clean them because it has something najis in them, which is the meat of the donkey. So if there is something najis in your pot or in your utensil, then it is obligatory to clean them. And so here we find the Prophet did not actually tell them to clean their containers which had khamr in them. So the opinion which we favor is the opinion of the minority of the scholars, which is that al-khamr is not najis. And this is an opinion which also gives some peace of mind to the people, because sometimes you may need to put certain intoxicants on for cleaning purposes. Like if you are receiving an injection, they may put on some alcohol, which is intoxicant, to clean your skin. If you say that al-khamr is najis, then it is not permissible for you to put this on, because it is not permissible for you to put on something which is najis. It's a bit like you putting on feces on yourself intentionally, or urine intentionally. From the fawaid of this hadith, we take the idea of closing off the doors which lead to evil, or prevention being better than cure. How is this? Because the Prophet ﷺ forbade the Muslim from turning the khamr into khal. Because if he allowed this, then the Muslims will keep their khamr so that they would turn it into vinegar or khal. And if we allow this, then it will lead to them drinking the khamr. Because if you encourage the Muslims to keep khamr in their homes, then you'll be encouraging them to drink it. Because it'll only be a matter of time when the Muslims will start drinking the khamr. So therefore, block off the door from the very first instance and order them to completely get rid of the khamr. We also take from the fawa'id that one word can serve as a whole sentence. This is because the Prophet ﷺ replied, La, no. And he did not reply in a whole complete sentence. So if you are conducting a transaction, be it a sales transaction or a marriage transaction or anything else, then if one word is used, then a whole transaction can be successfully conducted. Because one word can be substituted for a whole sentence if it is clearly understood what this one word means by both parties. Hadith number 23, on the authority of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, he says, لَمَّا كَانَ يَوْمُ خَيْبَرْ أَمَرَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَّلَّمَ أَبَا طَلْحَةَ فَنَادَى إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ يَنْهَيَانِكُمْ عَنْ لُحُومِ الْحُمُرِ الْأَهْلِيَّةِ فَإِنَّهَا رِجِسٌ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. On the day of the conquest of Khaybar, the Prophet sent Abu Talha and he announced to the people in a loud voice, Verily Allah and His Messenger have both prohibited the meat of the donkey because it is rijis, meaning najis. The hadith is muttafaqun alayhi. Khaybar is a city about 160 kilometers north of Medina. And it used to have a group of Yahud living in it. And the Prophet ﷺ conquered that city in the year 7th Hijri. And this happened when the Yahud broke the contract between the Muslims and themselves. The Prophet was going to expel the Yahud from Khaybar, except that they struck a deal with the Prophet that they would work on the farmland and the Muslims will have a share of what they produce. From the benefits we take from this hadith is that it is legislated that when you are teaching people or announcing something, then it must reach as many people as possible, because Abu Talha shouted out the ruling so that everybody could hear. And so nowadays, of course, you don't need to shout out, but we have microphones and speakers which will magnify the voice. Let us note what Abu Talha said, that verily Allah and the Messenger have prohibited the meat of the donkey. There is a discussion point here when he says, يَنْهَيَانِكُمْ, they both prohibit you. As we find Allah and the Messenger are both mentioned together in this verb, يَنْهَيَانِكُمْ. It is similar to the hadith in the Sahihain when the Prophet ﷺ said that one of you will not taste the sweetness of Iman until he finds three things, and one of them were أَنْ يَكُونَ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَحَبَّ إِلَيْهِ مِمَّا سِوَاهُمَا, that Allah and the Messenger are more beloved to him than anything other than them. So the word سِوَاهُمَا, other than them two. So Allah and the Messenger are lumped together in the pronoun huma, meaning them two. So it appears from this narration and the narration of the chapter that it is permissible to collect or combine between Allah and the Messenger altogether. However, we have another narration in Sahih Muslim in which the Prophet ﷺ heard a man giving a khutbah and the man said, مَنْ يُطِعِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ رَشَدْ وَمَنْ يَعْصِهِمَا فَقَدْ غَوَى. Whoever obeys Allah and the Messenger, then he is rightly guided. And whoever disobeys them too, then he has gone astray. And the Prophet told him, بِئْسَ الْخَطِيبُ أَنْتَ, what a bad preacher you are. And the Prophet corrected him. He told him that you should say, وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ غَوَى, whoever disobeys Allah and His Messenger, then he has gone astray. So he told him to split up Allah and the Messenger and to mention them separately and not to mention them all in one lump. So how do we reconcile between these two evidences which appear to clash? Meaning to say, is it permissible to mention Allah and the Messenger all together in one lump? Or do you have to necessarily mention them separately because we are receiving mixed messages from the narrations? The best explanation we believe is in the hadith of the chapter, which is hadith number 23, when Abu Talha said, يَنْهَيَانِكُمْ, they both prohibit you, then this is all part of one sentence. So verily Allah and His Messenger prohibit you. This is one sentence, therefore you can mention Allah and the Messenger both together in this verb. Likewise with the hadith of Allah and His Messenger being most beloved to Him. As for the khatib, the one giving the sermon, he actually mentioned two sentences. The first sentence was, whoever obeys Allah and His Messenger, then he has been rightly guided. And the second sentence he mentioned, and whoever disobeys them both, then he is misguided. So this second sentence is a new sentence. Therefore, it is recommended for him to mention Allah and the Messenger separately, because it's a separate sentence and it does not follow from the first sentence. They're two independent sentences. So there's one difference. The second difference is that the khatib, the one giving the sermon, was giving a khutbah, and the ulama say that the nature of the khutbah is that you should always try to detail out what you are saying. And so because of this, it is recommended to mention Allah and the Messenger separately, so as to make the khutbah more detailed. And from the fawaid of the hadith, we take that the meat of the donkey is impure. And we take this from the text of the hadith itself. Thus we find we are not allowed to eat the meat of the donkey, and also because it is impure, we're not allowed to drink the milk of the donkey. And when we talk about the meat of the donkey, we mean every single part of the donkey is not allowed to be eaten. This would even include the bones, because some ulama might say that bones are not part of the meat, therefore bones are allowed to be eaten, but we say no, the bones also follow in the same ruling, because it is possible to eat the bones. And we also find the good teaching technique is that when you give a ruling, then give the reason behind this ruling. So the meat of the donkey is haram because it is rijis, because it is najis. And so we take that everything which is najis is haram to be consumed. We take from the fawaid of this hadith that the humur ahliya is haram, and the humur ahliya are the donkeys. And there is also another type of hamir, which is the hamir wahshi, the wild donkey as they say, and this is the zebra. We take from this hadith that the zebra is halal to be eaten, because the hadith specifically mentions the donkey. And so the zebra is allowed to be eaten, and it is one of the well-known game animals. What about the donkey when it is living? Is it najis or not? The correct opinion is that it is not najis. And so the saliva of the donkey and the sweat of the donkey, it is all pure, because it comes under the same ruling as the cat. It is not najis because it is one of the tawafina, one of those which wanders around amongst the people. And so if it was given the ruling of being najis, this would cause great difficulty amongst the people, because it is very difficult to avoid something which is najis and is still wandering around the people, just like the cat. And there is no doubt that the people in those days would ride donkeys, and no doubt also that they would be affected by the sweat and the saliva of the donkey, and they were not told by the Prophet to take their precautions, which again strongly suggests that the donkey is pure when it is alive. In the full version of this hadith, which is in the Sahihain, we are told that the people were cooking the donkey meat in their pots in Khaybar, and the Prophet ﷺ, after explaining to them that this meat is najis, he told them to pour out the contents, and he told them to break the pot. Then it was suggested to him, could we not just clean the pot? And he told them, or you can clean it. And the reason why you have to clean the pots is because the meat is najis. So if you have an impurity in your utensils, then you must clean the utensil. Hadith 24, on the authority of Amr ibn Khalija, he says, خَطَبَنَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ بِمِنَى وَهُوَ عَلَى رَاحِلَتِهِ وَلُعَابُهَا يَسِيلُ عَلَى كَتِفِي أَخْرَجَهُ أَحْمَدْ وَالتِّرْمِذِي وَصَحَّحَ. He says that the Prophet ﷺ was giving us a khutbah in Mina, and he was on his riding animal, and the saliva of the animal was falling on my shoulders. Ahmad al-Tirmidhi reported it, and the hadith is authentic, sahih. So we learn from this hadith that the Prophet ﷺ was giving a khutbah in Mina, and we also know that the Prophet gave a khutbah on the day of Arafah, which on the farewell Hajj was on a Friday. And that khutbah at Arafah was not the khutbah of Yawm al-Jum'ah, because the Prophet ﷺ did not pray Salat al-Jum'ah that day. Rather, he prayed Dhuhr, and he combined between Salat al-Dhuhr and Asr, as is reported. So it is legislated for the Imam to give a khutbah on Arafah and afterwards at Mina, so he can explain to the people the rulings of the Hajj. We can take from this hadith that it is permissible to give a khutbah sitting down. And the Prophet was sitting down on his camel, and he was on a higher level than everyone else, so that everybody could see him and hear him properly. So the one giving the sermon should be on a higher level, so everybody could see him and hear him properly. Otherwise, the sunnah when it comes to giving the khutbah on Yawm al-Jum'ah is to do it standing up, because this was the continuous sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ. But the shahid from this hadith is the point when he says that the saliva of this camel was falling on my shoulders. It means that the saliva of the camel is pure, because the Prophet ﷺ did not tell Amr ibn Kharija to clean himself. We can take from this that every animal which is halal to be eaten, then its saliva and its sweat is pure. In fact, the urine and feces are also pure of those animals which are allowed to be eaten, like the camel and the chicken and the sheep and the horse and the zebra and so on. Because the Prophet ﷺ, in another narration which is famous in the Sahih, he ordered some ill people to drink from the urine of the camel. So we find those animals which are halal to be eaten, then their body parts and that which comes out from them is zahir, except for flowing blood, because in this case we have a text from the Quran which tells us that flowing blood is rijis, which means najis. And we quoted the ayah from Surah Al-An'am before. Somebody might say, but is it not possible that the Prophet ﷺ did not see the saliva falling on the shoulder of Amr? Firstly, the answer to this is that this is highly unlikely. But even if we assume that this was the case, if the Prophet did not notice, we have a qa'idah which teaches us that what the Prophet did not know during his life, then Allah Jalla wa'ala certainly did know. And so if there was something wrong which is going on, then Allah would have revealed it on the mouth of his Prophet, or he would have sent down an ayah. And Allah Jalla wa'ala says about the munafiqeen, يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ النَّاسِ وَلَا يَسْتَخْفُونَ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَهُوَ مَعْهُمْ إِذْ يُبَيِّتُونَ مَا لَا يَرْضَى مِنَ الْقَوْلِ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا يَعْمَلُونَ مُحِيطًا. They hide themselves from the people, but they cannot hide themselves from Allah, and He is with them when they make their plans which He is not pleased with, and Allah encompasses all that they do. Likewise, Jabir radiallahu anhu said that they would be practicing al-azl whilst the Qur'an was being revealed. So he's telling us that if it was haram, then the Qur'an certainly would have made mention of it. This is because Allah does not keep quiet on those things which are not permissible. As for the urine and feces of those animals which you are not allowed to eat, then this is impure. So even though the cat is pure, but the urine and feces of the cat is impure because the cat is not allowed to be eaten. The same thing with the donkey and all other animals which are not allowed to be eaten. We can take from the hadith that if you have a group of people going on Hajj, then they should have one knowledgeable person at least who can guide them to the rituals of the Hajj. And it is also recommended for him to give a khutbah on Yawm Arafah and also on the second day of Tashriq, because this hadith is talking about the Prophet giving the khutbah on the second day of Tashriq. And this is where you would have to explain to them the rest of the rituals and also the obligation of performing the Tawaf al-Wada'. We also learn from the narration that Amr ibn Kharija was standing beneath the Prophet. So there's no problem in the khatib using the services of someone to help him deliver the khutbah, even if this person might be standing underneath him. And this is not considered to be pride on the part of the khatib, as long as the khatib does not feel any pride in his heart. Hadith 25. On the authority of Aisha radiallahu anha, she says, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يغسل المني ثم يخرج إلى الصلاة في ذلك الثوب وأنا أنظر إلى أثر الغسل. That the Prophet ﷺ would wash the semen of his clothes, and then he would go out to the salah in those clothes, and I would be looking at the effects of the washing on his clothes. The hadith is muttafaqun alayh. And in a version of Muslim, لقد كنت أفرقه من ثوب رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم فرقا فيصلي فيه. She said, I used to scrape it off from the clothes of the Prophet ﷺ, meaning to say scrape off the solidified semen, and the Prophet would pray in these clothes. And in a wording, لَقَدَ كُنْتُ أَحَقُّهُ يَابِسًا بِظُفْرِ مِنْ ثَوْبِهِ. I would scratch it off with my nails, meaning scratching the dried semen off, from his clothes. The liquid which comes out of the male copulatory organ is of four types. Al-mani, which is the semen. Al-madhi, which is the liquid which comes out due to sexual excitement, and this comes before the semen or the mani. Then you have the bowl, which is the urine, and you also have the wadi, which is a white liquid which could come out after urination. As for the bowl and the wadi, then both of these are impure and must be washed properly. which means that the water must run on the item of clothing affected, and the clothing also must be squeezed after the water has run on the clothing and washed. As for the madhi, then this is also najis, but a lighter form of najasa. It takes the same ruling as the urine of the baby which is breastfeeding and does not eat solid food out of his own desire. So if clothing is affected by the madhi, then as the Prophet ﷺ explained in the Sunan, that you take a handful of water and you simply moisten the affected area, or you can sprinkle water over it. And you do not need to make the water run over it and squeeze the clothing just as you would do in a normal washing. So just to wetten the affected area is sufficient, just like the urine of the baby which does not eat solid food out of his own desire. As for when the mani comes out, then a man needs to take a ghusl, which is a bath, of janaba. It doesn't have to be a bath, it could be a shower, just as long as the whole body is washed. Because when you're in a state of janaba, you are in a state of major hadath, and only a full bathing can take you out of this. And you require this bathing when the semen comes out after the sexual excitement, because sometimes semen could come out due to some illness. This does not require a bath of janaba. And this is taken from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, which is authentically reported in the Sunan, in which he said to one of his companions, إِذَا حَذَفْتَ فَاغْتَسِلْ مِنَ الْجَنَابَةِ وَإِذَا لَمْ تَكُنْ حَاذِفًا فَلَا تَغْتَسِلْ. If you shoot the semen out, then take a bath of janaba, but if you don't shoot the semen out, then do not take a bath. So the semen is only shot out after the sexual stimulation. We can take from this hadith that there are certain things which a person may feel shy to speak about, but sometimes he just has to speak about them because teaching is necessary. So here we find Aisha radiallahu anha is teaching us about how to deal with the semen on the clothes. We also take from the fawaid that if you have semen on your clothes, then you should wash it off, or if it is dried, then you should scrape it off. But the big question in this narration is, are you cleaning this off because it is najis, or are you cleaning it because it simply does not look good and the Muslim needs to be presentable? Some ulama say that al-mani, which is the semen, is najis because the Prophet ﷺ would wash it from his clothing, and if it was not najis, he would not need to wash it. And they also said that if it was dried, then we know that Aisha would scrape it off the clothing of the Prophet. And they say that this scraping is also removing the impurity, because they say that water is not the only thing which removes the impurity, rather, scraping the impurity off also removes it. So whether you scrape it off if it is dry, or whether you wash it when it is moist, either way you have to get rid of the mani because it is impure. And this is one opinion. The second opinion is that the mani is pure. And they argue saying that, look how the Prophet ﷺ left the mani on the clothes until it became dry. If it had been najis, he would have washed it straight away. They also say that scraping the mani off when it is dried does not completely remove it. There will always be some elements of the dried mani left on the clothing if you scrape it. If the najasa is on a smooth surface, then if you were to scrape it off, then yes, it would get rid of the najasa. Because if it's on a smooth and plain surface, then scraping would remove it. But on clothing, scraping would not remove the najasa completely. So they say that this proves that mani is not najis because the Prophet ﷺ would pray in the clothing in which there was mani. What appears to be the correct opinion is that al-mani is not najis, because if it had been najis, then the Prophet ﷺ would have ordered Aisha radiallahu anha to completely wash it and squeeze it with water, just as we are going to see in the hadith coming up about removing the blood of the menses. The Prophet ordered that it should be scraped and then squeezed or pinched with water, and then water should be poured on it. So this is the instruction which he gave. If the mani had been impure, just like the blood of the menses, then the same or similar instructions would have been given. But rather we find just scraping it off was enough. And this scraping is not because it is impure, but rather it is because having traces of mani on your clothing does not look presentable. So just in the same way, if you have some mucus on your clothing, you would not leave it there and walk out with this mucus on your clothing. Rather, you would remove it. But that does not mean that the mucus is impure. Rather, we know that the mucus is pure. And also, we cannot use an analogy between al-mani and al-bawl, because when it comes to urine and feces, then they are leftovers of the food which you have taken. As for the mani, which is the semen, it is not left over from the food, but rather this is something produced in the body naturally. So they are two different substances entirely. So there can be no qiyas or analogy between them. We also take from this hadith that a wife serves her husband in everyday affairs. Because here we find Aisha radiallahu anha cleaning the clothes of the Prophet. And this is all part of the command of Allah Jalla wa Ala when he says, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and live with them in a goodly fashion or honorably. So we find that it all depends on the customs of the people. A man should treat his wife and a woman should treat her husband in accordance with what is well known in the customs of the people and in accordance with what the people deem to be good. Of course, this could vary from place to place. Some women, for example, may require a servant in some places, and in other places, it is not customary to have a servant in the house. We also take from this hadith that the Prophet ﷺ did not have many items of clothing, because if he did have many items of clothing, he would have put the clothing with the semen on it in the wash and put on some new clothing. But he didn't. Rather, he recycled, as it were, the old clothing. And this shows that the Prophet ﷺ was not interested in the luxuries of this life. The ulama have mentioned that from the specific aspects of the Prophet is that he does not have a wet dream. So this sperm which was on the clothing must have been from sexual intercourse and not from the wet dream. Hadith number 26, on the authority of Abu Samh radiallahu anh, that the Prophet ﷺ said, يُغْسَلُ مِنْ بَوْلِ الْجَارِيَةِ وَيُرَشُّ مِنْ بَوْلِ الْغُلَامِ أَخْرَجَهُ أَبُو دَاوُودِ وَالنَّسَائِي وَصَحَّحَهُ الْحَاكِمِ. The Prophet said that the urine of the baby girl should be washed and the urine of the baby boy should have water sprinkled on it. The hadith is sahih. So this hadith is giving the ruling about the urine of the baby boy and girl who are at the breastfeeding stage. This is the baby whose most of his food intake is from the mother's milk, and the minority of his food intake, if at all, is from solid food. So this is the type of baby we are talking about. As for if the child is eating solid food more than it is taking the breast milk, then this hadith does not apply. And this hadith proves to us that the urine of these types of baby boy and girl are both impure, but the one of the baby girl is more impure than the baby boy, because the girl's urine needs to be washed properly with the water flowing on the item of clothing, whereas the urine of the baby boy just needs to have water sprinkled on it. Normally in the Sharia, the rule is that whatever applies to a male applies to a female. And so this is one of the exceptions. The ulama have suggested the reasons for the difference, and one of the reasons suggested is because the urine of the baby boy sprinkles out a lot more, so it reaches wider places, and hence it would be more difficult to wash, whereas that of the baby girl normally lands on one place. But Allah Jalla wa'ala knows best what the hikmah is, as the wisdom behind this hadith has not been explained in the hadith itself. So it is upon us to believe in it and act in accordance with it, as long as we know that it is authentically reported to the Prophet, which it is. As for the feces of the male and female babies, then this is all impure and it takes one and the same ruling. When the baby grows up and most of its food intake is from solid food and not the breast milk, then the ruling is the same. The urine and feces of everyone is impure and needs a thorough cleaning. Hadith 27, on the authority of Asma bint Abi Bakr radiallahu anhuma, that the Prophet said about the blood of the menstrual cycle, which affects the clothing of the woman, when asked how to remove it, he said, تَحُتُّهُ ثُمَّ تَقْرُصُهُ بِالْمَاءِ ثُمَّ تَنْضَحُهُ ثُمَّ تُصَلِّ فِيهِ مُتَّفَقٌ عَلَيْهِ. She scrapes off the blood when it is dry, then she squeezes it or pinches it with water. So the clothing is moist with water and she pinches it. And then she puts water on the affected place and then she prays in the clothing. The hadith is muttafaqun alayh. We take from the hadith that the menstrual blood is najis because the woman is ordered to clean it before she prays. And even a little amount of this blood must be cleansed. Many ulama hold that the normal blood of a human is najis, it's impure, but a little bit of normal blood can be overlooked. But who decides what a little bit is? Is it the individual person who decides, or that which is decided by the common folk, meaning the generally acceptable opinion? The answer is the second, as some people could be affected by waswasa And on the other extreme, some people could just take it too easy. So with a large quantity of human blood, they would say, this is just a small amount. It's the same thing with the lost items. We know that if the lost item you find is of a little value, then you are allowed to keep it because the owner who lost this item will not come back searching for it if it is of a small value. But then who decides what a small value is? Is it the individual person or that which is generally accepted to be of a small value? The answer is the second. We find that the blood of the menses is najis, and this is also part of the reason why the man is not allowed to have intercourse with the woman, is because he will be touching najasa, or exposing himself to najasa in any case. And we also take from this hadith that it is one of the conditions for your salah to be correct, that you should have najasa removed from your clothing, and for that matter also from your body. And we also know that you need to have najasa removed from the place of prayer. And we know this from the hadith of the A'rabi, who came and urinated in the masjid, and the Prophet ordered that a bucket of water be brought and water spilt on the urine. We take from the fawaid of this hadith that the Sahaba, and in this case the women, did not have too many items of clothing, because if they did, then the woman could easily just wash the clothing which was affected by the menses blood and wear a second item of clothing, but they didn't. They would rather wash the affected area of the clothing and pray in them. And you can contrast this to people nowadays. They have a massive wardrobe which is full of different clothing, because people nowadays are indulging in the good things of life and have forgotten about the hereafter, which is inevitable when you indulge in this life too much. And as the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith in the Sunan, مَنْ سَكَنَ الْبَادِيَ جَفَى وَمَنْ اتَّبَعُ الصَّيْدَ غَفَلَى وَمَنْ أَتَى السُّلْطَانِ افْتَتَنَ. Whoever lives in the countryside is of rough nature, and whoever follows the game animals becomes heedless, and whoever comes to the sultan, the ruler, he becomes embroiled in fitna. So the shahid is, the second part, whoever chases the game animals, meaning to say you occupy yourself in the hobbies of this world too much, you will become ghafil, heedless of Allah Jalla wa'ala and his dhikr, and also the hereafter. And this applies to all types of hobbies, not just chasing game animals, which was the main hobby in those days. Nowadays it applies to playing computer games, watching films, theatres, cinemas, and playing football. Some hobbies could be haram in and of themselves, and some hobbies could be halal in and of themselves, but indulging in them too much would make you ghafil, or heedless of the remembrance of Allah and of the hereafter. So may Allah Jalla wa'ala protect us from indulging in the hobbies of this life. We also take from this hadith that you remove the najasa in stages. Just as explained here, you scrape it off first, then you pinch it with water, and then you pour water over the affected area. And we also take that you do not need to pour water excessively over the affected area after the najasa has been removed. Remember, when the najasa is removed, then its ruling is also removed. And so you are now able to pray in this clothing. That is the blood of hayd, the menstrual blood. What about the blood of istihadha, which is the prolonged bleeding? The blood of istihadha is not the same as the blood of the menstrual cycle. The istihadha blood is normal blood, and the menstrual cycle blood is different. The ulama say that it looks different, and it has a different texture, and it also smells different. And Allah Jalla wa'ala calls it adha, when he says, يَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنِ الْمَحِيضِ قُلْ هُوَ adha. They ask you about the menstruation, say it is an adha, which is a harmful thing. And it can also mean an impure thing. So there is clearly a difference between menstrual blood and the normal blood. Most of the ulama say that when it comes to normal human blood, it is impure, but if a little bit of it comes on your clothes, then this is forgiven and you do not need to wash it. As for menstrual blood, no doubt you need to wash it, whether it is a little amount or a large amount. And so we find the vast majority of the ulama say that when human blood comes out, it is najis. And they use the ayah from the Qur'an, and it is found in Surah Al-An'am, which says that the damam masfuhan, the poured out blood, is rijis. And rijis means najis. And of course this includes human blood. However, if somebody was to make an exception and say that this does not include human blood, then this would in fact be a good opinion. The way that this opinion can be argued is to use some evidences and say that, firstly, we know that the martyrs of Uhud, when they died, the Prophet ﷺ did not order that their blood should be washed off. if blood was najis, the Prophet would have ordered blood to be washed. Most of the ulama say that this is because the blood of the martyr is pure, and normal blood is not pure. But it could easily be argued that the Prophet did not order the blood to be washed because human blood is simply pure, and it makes no difference whether this is the blood of a martyr or not. What it is for sure is that this blood was from humans, because after all it was humans who died. Also we know from the life of the Prophet ﷺ is that many people were affected by blood, like nosebleeds and injuries from wars and many other causes, and it has not been narrated from the Prophet that he ordered the blood to be washed, in the same way he ordered the blood of the menses to be washed. And also we know that the companions would have been praying in bloody clothes because of the fighting, and it has not been reported that the Prophet ordered them to clean this blood or to change their clothing or anything of that sort. Also we know that the Prophet ﷺ ordered a tent to be erected in the masjid for Sa'ad ibn Mu'adh when he was injured in the Battle of the Trench, and the Prophet would visit him in the masjid. But the point is that the injured person is going to be bleeding, and this would expose the masjid to the blood. And of course you're not allowed to expose the masjid to impurity. So this would tend to suggest that blood is pure. Also we can use an analogy based on the fish. We know that the blood of the fish is pure. The reason why the blood of the fish is pure is because the dead fish is pure, and the dead animal only is impure because of the blood which is stored inside. So if the dead fish is pure, then its blood is also pure. So if you have blood of a fish on your clothing, you can pray in this clothing, and you are not required to wash it for your prayer to be correct. But we can use an analogy and say that the dead human is also pure, and nobody says that the dead human is impure. If the dead human is pure, then it must mean that the blood inside this dead human is also pure, exactly like the fish. Because remember, the dead animal is only impure because of the blood which is stored inside. Another analogy, we know the general rule that when a piece of someone's body is cut off, then that takes the ruling as if the animal is dead. And we spoke about this before. So based upon this, we say that if a piece of a fish is cut off, then this cut off piece is pure because the dead fish is pure. If a leg of a sheep is cut off, then this leg is impure because the dead sheep is impure. When we say dead, of course we mean died a natural death, or a death which is not done using the halal slaughter method. So now let's apply this to the human. If let's say a human hand is cut off, what's the ruling on this? We say the ruling is that this hand which is cut off is pure. Why? Because the dead human is pure. So if this cut off hand is pure, and we know that this cut off hand has blood inside it, then the blood should be even more so pure. Some people may argue back and say, but you do admit that the urine feces of a human is impure. So why not also say the same thing about the blood? We say there is a difference between urine and feces and blood. One is resulting from an excess food, and it smells and it doesn't look good, and the human soul feels averse to it. As for blood, it is not the same. And there is also the famous opinion that a small amount of human blood does not need to be washed. But they do not say the same thing with the urine and feces, that a small amount of urine and feces does not need to be washed. So there is clearly a difference between blood and urine and feces. They might also argue back and say, is it not true that Fatima, the daughter of the Prophet, washed the face of the Prophet during the Battle of Uhud because the face of the Prophet became bloodied? We say yes, she did wash the face, but that doesn't prove that blood is najis. Rather, you could wash something off and it is not najis. If you have some vomit or mucus on you, would you not wash it off? But does this mean that this is impure? No, it is still pure. Also, this is merely an action, and mere actions without statement does not signify an obligation, so that it is obligatory to wash the blood. And this rule is well known in Usulul Fiqh. So all in all, we are saying that the majority opinion is that the blood which comes out of the human is impure. And some scholars may even have stated that there is an ijma' on this issue. And the minority opinion is that the blood which comes out of the human is pure. So upon this, if you have a nosebleed or some cut and blood comes onto your clothing, then your prayer would not be correct until you wash off this blood, according to the majority opinion. According to the minority opinion, which is a decent opinion, if some blood comes onto your clothing because of a nosebleed or some cut which you have, then you do not need to wash this blood off. and your prayer is correct without washing it off. However, the blood which comes out through the urine passage or the passage of the feces, then this is deemed to be impure because it takes the same ruling as the urine and feces because it is coming out of the same passage. So if you have blood coming out of the passage of the urine or the feces, then this is impure and it needs to be cleaned. And your prayer cannot be correct without washing it first. As for other types of blood, which do not come out through these two passages, then to say that this blood from humans is pure would be a good opinion, even if it is the minority opinion. A big issue arising from this hadith is water the only substance to get rid of an-najasa? Because as we find in this case, the Prophet gives instructions to use water to remove the blood of the menses. The correct opinion appears to be that water is not the only substance, but rather water is the most ideal substance. However, when it comes to removing impurity, then however the impurity is removed, it is removed. And so the ruling of impurity is also removed, such that you are able to pray in these clothings. There are many evidences for this opinion. For example, all the ahadith which talk about istijmar, then this is removing impurity with other than water. So it's removing the impurity with stones. Or you could also use tissue. Anything which will remove the impurity. Also in Sunan Abi Dawood, the Prophet ﷺ authentically said, إِذَا وَطِئَ أَحَدُكُمْ بِنَعْلِهِ الْأَذَى فَإِنَّ التُّرَابَ لَهُ طَهُورٌ. If one of you steps on some dirt with his sandals, then the dust which comes after it will purify. And so the word أَذَى in this hadith can also refer to impurity. Also the Prophet authentically said, إِذَا جَاءَ أَحَدُكُمُ الْمَسْجِدِ فَلْيُقَلِّبْ نَعْلَيْهِ وَلْيَنْظُرْ فِيهِمَا فَإِنْ رَأَى خَبَثًا فَلْيَمْسَحُ بِالْأَرْضِ ثُمَّ لْيُصَلِّ فِيهِمَا. When one of you comes to the masjid, then let him turn his sandals and take a look at them. If he sees any impurity or any dirt, and the word used is khabath, then let him wipe it with the earth and then pray in them. Also in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, Salama radiallahu anha asked the Prophet والسلام, إِنِّي امْرَأَةٌ أُطِيلُ ذَيْلِي وَأَمْشِي فِي الْمَكَانِ الْقَذِرِ فَقَالَ لَهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يُطَهِّرُهُ مَا بَعْدَهُ. She said to the Prophet, I am a woman who lets her clothing hang down which touches the ground, and I walk over places which are dirty. So the Prophet replied, whatever comes after it will purify. So whenever you walk over pure land, then this would purify the dirt which has come onto your clothing. So the point is that all of this is purification without water. We also take from the fawaid of this hadith that when you are removing impurity, washing it 7 times is not a condition, and that this is specific to the dog. Because there are some of the ulama who say that when you are getting rid of the impurity, you need to wash it 7 times, and this is not correct. And this hadith is evidence, because the Prophet did not mention 7 washings.
Let us take some review questions. Question number 1. State the 2 conditions under which you may eat from the plates and utensils of the kuffar. And then state whether these conditions are actual conditions of validity or merely just being on the safe side. Question number 2. Give reasons for the opinion which states that khamr is actually dahir and not najis. Question number 3. Give 3 reasons to argue for the opinion that the blood of a human is tahir and not najis.